is why investors continue to stay on the sidelines.
The expectation is for inflation to pick up a little bit.
To trade this market,
take advantage of the strength.
The biggest news, the most compelling stories, and issues that matter to you. Top Story, Monday to Saturday at 5 p.m. here on ANC.
All right, we're back.
Join David Celdran.
We were lucky to have filmed in South America and Europe. Plus some new ones now that destinations in the Philippines are starting to open up.
Marie Lozano. And Martin Avera.
Expect the unexpected as we talk to some of your favorite people and turn their long stories into short stories.
As all new episodes of Executive Class, Cityscape, and LSS The Martin Avera Show return on a new time slot. Only here on ANC.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines. The latest news and information you get on radio, TV, and the internet are now in the ABS-CBN Radio Service app. Stream anytime, anywhere with BZMM Radyo Patrol, plus different podcast content from ABS-CBN News and the ABS-CBN News Channel. Download the ABS-CBN Radio Service app now, available on Google Play Store and Apple App Store. The Philippines. We are ANC. The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
It's Wednesday, March 31 here in Manila. I'm Karen Davila, working from home this Wednesday morning, giving you the head start for the day. On Hot Copy this morning, we'll be speaking with Guigo de Guzman, son of Claire de la Fuente. Everyone still in shock with the passing of the Karen Carpenter of the Philippines. Details on her final moments later on in the show. And why didn't she able or why wasn't she able to get the care that she needed. Also on Hot Copy, we'll be speaking with Father Luciano Pelloni, parish priest of the Kristong Hari Church, as we reflect about the Holy Week during the time of the pandemic. First, the headlines. Today's big stories, the Philippines now has the highest number of active COVID-19 cases in Southeast Asia. Labor groups ask the government to speed up aid distribution in areas under the ECQ. And China finalizes a sweeping overhaul of Hong Kong's electoral system. The Philippines logs the highest number of active COVID-19 cases in Southeast Asia, with new infections exceeding 9,000 for a fifth straight day, Rafael Bosano reports.
Even as the capital region and nearby provinces have been placed under the most restrictive enhanced community quarantine status, bringing down the numbers will not be easy. Like last year's ECQ, the aim is to greatly reduce the transmission of the virus and allow an ailing healthcare system to breathe. But health spokesperson Maria Rosario Vergere herself believes it will take weeks before results are delivered. On Tuesday, the country logged 9,226 new infections. Nearly 57,000 new cases have been recorded in just 6 days, surpassing the monthly totals from November 2020 to February 2021. As active cases reach more than 124,000, a lot remain asymptomatic and even more mild. But the fact that almost 1,600 are in severe and critical conditions is something that should not be taken lightly. While age groups have recorded severe and critical cases of the disease, most are still aged 60 and above. The DOH has earlier said that senior citizens are less likely to get infected as they are usually indoors. But if ever they do, they have a higher chance of becoming critical or even die. The Okta Research Group warns the trend of full hospitals is still likely to be the case in the coming weeks.
And it will be full for a while because hindi iyan bababa agad yung numbers. We could have this situation for maybe 2 or 3 more weeks at the least. Na yung mga hospitals ay puno. Hindi tayo nagsusugarcoat. I mean, I wish I could give you a better outlook.
From 2.05 last week, the reproduction number in the NCR has slightly decreased to 1.86. While it can be seen that the spread has slowed down, this is different from decreasing cases, as a 1.86 reproduction number still means that for every 100 COVID-19 patients, 186 more are likely to get infected. Professor David says lower numbers may be recorded in the next couple of days, but this doesn't necessarily mirror the actual situation.
Hindi ibig sabihin on a downward trend na tayo kasi every week talaga mababa talaga yung Tuesdays and Wednesdays numbers and then Thursday tataas ulit. Pero there's another consideration dahil we are expecting that holidays, yung mga ibang testing centers, baka maraming testing centers mag-close during this Holy Week. It might cause an artificial decrease.
It takes around 9 days before a patient with COVID-19 is isolated. The DOH explains that this is because it takes a couple of days for the patients to decide whether or not to seek consult and another couple of days before getting tested and actually receiving the results. This means that even before isolation, a patient may have already been able to infect other people. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Now, labor groups urge the Philippine government to ensure the speedy distribution of aid to low-income residents in areas under an enhanced community quarantine. As Jeffrey Hernaez tells us, Metro Manila mayors prefer to give assistance in kind instead of cash.
Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte approves the distribution of aid to nearly 23 million individuals affected by the lockdown. That's 80% of the low-income population inside the NCR Plus bubble. They will receive 1,000 pesos per individual or 4,000 pesos per family through the extended social amelioration program. Budget Department assures the public that there is enough money for the program.
Diretsuhin kita, may pera tayo.
Ah, meron, Mr. President. Meron po. Kakaasa po kayo, may pera po tayo. Ito nga po ang funding source natin, 23 billion po. So makita natin doon sa total kanina, umabot lang ng 22.9. So may natira pa tayong konti sa 23 billion.
Avisado also says the amount may be given in kind or in cash depends on the preference of local government units. But mayors prefer to give essential goods, according to Metro Manila Council Chair Parañaque City Mayor Edwin Olivares.
Ina-download yung pera, bibili ang LGU po ng ating pong, ng goods, tapos ibibigay po sa mga tao. Pag ganun po yun, sufficiente na po yan. Kapag po 4,000 per household, napakaganda po niyan. Kailangan po natin ng bigas, kailangan po natin ng dilata, kailangan po natin ng noodles. Yung pong basic lang po ibibigay.
Labor groups urge the government to make sure the aid will actually reach those who need it.
Ang panawagan po namin, kahit kanina yan dumaan, Basta pabilisin nila, huwag nilang pahirapan yung pagbibigay ng ayuda sa mga manggagawa.
Sa ngayon po ay minimal pa rin ang nakakatanggap ng ayuda mula sa pamahalaan. Kaya't ito na naman ay nangako na naman sila na magbibigay sila na uli ng ayuda.
The Labor Department will also provide aid to affected workers. This includes the 5,000 peso one-time cash assistance under the COVID-19 Adjustment Measures Program or CAMP and emergency employment under the TUPAD Program. Employers must submit the names of their affected employees for them to receive the emergency fund.
Meron po tayong handang tulong para sa ating mga manggagawa na mali-displaced dahil dito sa bagong quarantine level. I'm sure marami sa ating mga kababayan, na mga workers, mga empleyado na maaaring hindi makapasok sa trabaho dahil dito.
Jeffrey Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Now, the number of jobless Filipinos rises to 4.2 million in February, despite the government's efforts to reopen the economy further. Bruce Rodriguez tells us the full story.
Vendor Nita has been forced to borrow from loan sharks to be able to sell various products along a sidewalk in Quezon City after she lost her job as a seamstress. While initially able to make both ends meet with her income from peddling, the pandemic and the imposition of a stricter lockdown again in Metro Manila has made life harder for her.
Hindi pa ako nakabayad ngayon sa bahay. Wala, lockdown, walang kita.
She's part of the 4.2 million Filipinos who were jobless in February this year based on the latest data from the Philippine Statistics Authority or PSA. That is already 200,000 higher than the figure reported in January. This translates to an unemployment rate of 8.8% for February from 8.7% in the month prior. National statistician Dennis Mapa says the increase in jobless figures was expected as more Filipinos started looking for jobs with the local economy slowly reopening. But he notes many establishments across the country were still shuttered or operating in a limited capacity.
Kung titingnan natin, slight ang increase. Talagang may expectation naman na mataas yung unemployment rate dahil marami talaga yung pumasok sa labor force, 2.1 million.
The accommodation and food services sector saw a 131,000 increase in the number of unemployed to 1.3 million. And as Filipinos struggle to make both ends meet amid the pandemic and lockdowns, more workers have also been seeking additional work. The underemployment rate rose to 18.2% in February from 16% in January, translating to 7.9 million Filipinos. The latest unemployment figures still don't include the potential impact of the return of the strictest lockdown protocols in Metro Manila and surrounding urbanized provinces. MAPA says they will only see the impact of this on the labor market by April.
Kung pagbabasihan natin yung mga nakaraang ECQ natin or even the MECQ noong August last year ay talagang bumaba ang labor force participation rate at may kataasan yung ating unemployment.
But according to the economic managers of the Duterte administration, while the unemployment rate rose, so did the number of Filipinos who were able to find jobs in February, particularly in the wholesale and retail trade and repair of vehicles and motorcycle sector, which saw an increase of nearly a million jobs. They also assure the public the government will not waste the stricter lockdown imposed in the capital and nearby areas by making sure they're able to slow down the spread of the virus as well as recalibrate their COVID-19 response strategies. Bruce Rodriguez, ABS-CBN News.
Malacañang now says private firms still need to enter into a tripartite deal, even after President Duterte has announced that he is allowing private companies to import their own vaccines at will. Alvin El Chico has the story.
To ramp up supply and push more vaccination, President Rodrigo Duterte had allowed the private sector to import COVID vaccines.
I have ordered Secretary Galvez to sign any and all documents that would allow the private sector to import at will Baski ilang kano, ilan ang gusto nilang ipasok, okay sa akin.
The Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry, which earlier appealed to directly import vaccines, welcomes the President's decision. PCCI Treasurer Sergio Ortiz Luis says some members have already initialed talks with suppliers from India and the U.S. The group adds there are ways to ensure that the private sector will not take advantage of the importation.
Dilagyan natin ng batas, penalty, yung magdinegosyo yan yun ang baguhin doon sa guideline. Ika-accredit naman nila kung sino yung mag-i-import.
But the President issued a warning to businessmen.
I'm just warning you, huwag na huwag kayong magkamali dito na hirap na ang Pilipino tapos dagdagan mo ng ganitong pamaraan ng hanap buhay.
Malacanang clarifies, businessmen who want to import COVID-19 vaccines still need to enter into a tripartite agreement with government.
Dahil lahat po ito ay covered pa lamang ng emergency use authorization, wala pa pong approval for commercial use ang kahit anong bakuna. Importante pa rin po ang lagda ng gobyerno dahil nga po doon sa indemnity provision ng ating batas, no, na kailan lang po ay naisabatas po ng ating Kongreso na kung meron pong side effects, gobyerno pa rin ang magbabayad.
Vaccine czar Carlito Galvez Jr. clarifies the President's directive allowing private sectors to buy their own vaccines is only meant to speed up the procurement process.
Ang direktiba po ng ating mahal na Presidente ay dapat pabilisin po yung proseso. Dapat wala pong delay para at least wala pong proceed na kinokontrol po natin yung tatawag nating procurement. Dahil kasi yung ating vaccine ay nasa emergency use authorization pa po, yun po ang limitation that they should not have a profit on this. Sinasabi tayo no profit, no loss. At the same time, no commercialization.
Presidential Advisor for Entrepreneurship Joey Concepcion says all their pending orders will still be under a tripartite agreement with the government.
If the indemnification can be done without a tripartite agreement, then that will be good. No, I mean, but we will have to go through all these pharma companies already who has agreements with us. No, so nakasanayan na yan eh. So the next order of Astra, they will want a tripartite agreement again.
In a statement, the Management Association of the Philippines says it welcomes the President's pronouncement. The group says it hopes authorities would no longer extend quarantine lockdowns to save businesses and the economy. Senators also welcome Mr. Duterte's move to allow the private sector to import vaccines. Senator Aimee Marcos says this will accelerate the inoculation program. Senator Angaro reminds businessmen that these vaccines cannot be sold but should only be procured for workers and their families. Senator Manny Pacquiao appeals to the private sector not to prioritize personal interest. But Senator Panfilo Lacson says, had the President done this earlier, the country could have been already vaccinating a huge portion of the population, possibly nearing the herd immunity. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
On Hot Coffee this morning, many are still in shock. Filipino music icon Claire De La Fuente passed away on Tuesday. She was only 63 years old. The singer was admitted to a hospital after testing a positive for COVID-19. De La Fuente was one of the pillars of original Filipino music, or OPM. She was also dubbed the Karen Carpenter of the Philippines for her vocal style. And this morning, Claire's son, Vico de Guzman, joins us on Hot Coffee. And Vigo, good morning to you.
Hi, good morning.
All right, before anything, first, I want to just give you my deepest condolences for the passing of your mom. You know, I've been in touch with you and your mom recently because of the De Sera case, and I am just one of the many who's really in shock with her passing. First, I want to ask you, you are COVID positive as well. Kamusta ka muna? How are you doing?
Well, right now, yes, I am COVID positive, but I'm asymptomatic. So I'm merely quarantining myself here in my room.
Okay. And what's very difficult in your situation is your mom has passed away and you cannot see the body.
Yeah.
My gosh.
Right now, there is no chance that I I can ever see her body again because I was told that they cannot open the body bag anymore.
Oh, so Gigo, who is handling, I mean, the affairs right now in the hospital, no? Sino ang nandun?
Well, her friends, actually, her closest friends who are like my titas, they're the ones who volunteered to take care of everything for us because we cannot leave the house, me and my brother. So they're the ones taking care of things. We are coordinating things over the phone because that's the best we could do.
Oo, napakahirap ng sitwasyon, Gigo. Kumbaga, when was the last time you actually saw your mom?
Last Saturday morning, because I slept beside her because she asked me to, because she was afraid of what was happening to her.
Oo. So last Saturday lang, this was March 27. When did she test positive for COVID, Gigo?
We both tested positive through antigen for COVID last Friday.
Okay.
And overnight, she was monitoring her condition. And the doctor eventually, you know, recommended that, told her that it would be best that she goes to the hospital so she could be monitored properly because her oxygen was low. But my mom seemed fine.
Yeah.
My mom
yeah.
was breathing properly. My mom didn't have her fever anymore. She was just nervous and anxious about what was happening to her.
Oh. So you were together March 27. When did she go to the hospital? On the 28th?
Saturday. Saturday lunchtime.
Saturday lunchtime would be technically the 27th.
Yeah.
Okay. Gigo, okay, ikwento mo sa akin, no? There are texts going around that your mom wasn't even able to enter the ER of the hospital. Is that correct?
Actually,
ikwento mo, and what hospital is this? So we just have an idea of just really the situation, no? That we are facing.
Actually, I'm not fully aware of what totally happened because my mom didn't want to tell me.
Okay.
She was more concerned about me, actually. So I found out that in Las Piñas Doctor's Hospital, she was in their waiting ward, which is, I think, their makeshift tent.
Yes, a tent.
Patients that cannot enter who cannot enter the ward because they couldn't fit. But fortunately, her last day, the day before her last, I was told that she was transferred to Pope John Paul II Hospital because they were able to find her a room in the ward there. That's why she was transferred. So she didn't. Correction to what I said yesterday. She didn't pass away in the ER. She actually passed away in the ward, being looked after by the doctors there.
Oh, so Gigo, how long was Claire in the tent? You know, the tent facility. Are we saying she was there for like 27, 28, 29? Kumbaga, it took a while for her to be in the ER.
She was there to the 29th.
Okay. And then, all right, well, that's like two nights.
Yeah, she was transferred to Pope John Paul II on the 29th. I'm not sure the time because I didn't even know she was being transferred. She failed to tell me. She only told me. I found out because she asked me to order her food, and I had it sent, but it was in the wrong hospital. So her last argument, Mom, why didn't you tell me that you were transferred? Sabi niya, oh, sorry anak, kalimutan ko.
Oo, grabe. Alam mo, Gigo, I'm sorry you have to recount this. No, I mean, I can only imagine what really you're going through. But did she fear death? I mean, was she fearing death when you spoke on the phone?
The thing is, my mom is, till the end, she didn't say anything. She did, however, fear death before she left the house.
Okay.
And I should have taken it as a sign when she called me and, anak, samahan mo ko dito sa kwarto. Kailangan ko ng kasama. So I slept beside her. And in a way, I guess she was slowly saying goodbye. I'm sure.
Oo. Do you believe, you know, Gigo, I just wanted to ask you, do you believe if your mom was able to get the immediate care she needed, like if she were, you know, she, if there was room in the ER, in Las Piñas doctors, if she was able to get the amount of oxygen she needed, I mean, do you believe she would be alive today?
Honestly, I don't think I blame anyone for this.
Yeah, definitely. This is the situation we're in. Yeah, and clearly so many Filipinos are experiencing waiting.
Yeah, my mom didn't really complain, I guess. We even bought her own oxygen tank here at home.
Okay.
I don't think... it's just a situation, I guess.
Yes, yeah. You bought her own oxygen tank at home. Because why would you do that? I mean, just to prepare, or because previously she'd had problems already that you believe, you know, she would need it?
Yeah, she was told by her doctor that her oxygen levels were low.
When she tested positive? Mm-hmm. Okay. And bumili kayo kaagad?
Yeah, she ordered, we actually ordered two. One is the big one, one is the small one, that just so she could have one while she went to the hospital to get her tests.
Oh, wow. Were you able to, what was the last conversation you had with her? Was it about the food?
Yeah, actually the last was, I called her and, she said, anak, mamaya ka na, I can't talk right now. I think she was having a hard time. Kasi I heard that hinihingil na nga daw siya.
Oo. When, di ba, nung una nandun siya sa Las Piñas doctors, hindi siya mabigyan ng space sa ER, then lumipat siya ng hospital sa Pope John Paul is the name of the hospital, Gigo. When you were speaking with her on the phone, did she complain already of like labored breathing? Anything else? Did she mention that?
Wala po eh. She actually just, she seemed fine, honestly.
Wow.
Until my brother told me nga na he called and hingal na hingal daw si mama. And so I called her, but she didn't want to talk to me. So I texted her, Ma, what are you feeling? Tight chest ba?
Uh-oh.
Her last reply to me was hingal na hingal, and she didn't reply after that.
Oh. Itong hingal na hingal, she replied to you on the 29th or the morning of the 30th?
29th.
On the 29th. Did you get word, Gigo, was your mom intubated? What was the situation before she passed?
I believe she wasn't intubated. She was actually, I'm not sure. I think the reason why she didn't want to talk to me was she was wearing her oxygen mask.
Yes. Uh-oh.
And then she could, based on what the doctor told me, she was when she found out that she was COVID positive on the 29th, the night of the 29th, when she started having, naghihingal na nga siya. She started being anxious. That's when her anxiety kicked in, her hypertension, and she couldn't sleep throughout the night. I think she fell asleep late at night na. And around before 6, past 6, I believe, her heart stopped. Yeah, she had cardiac arrest while asleep.
Yeah. No, she had cardiac arrest even if she was getting the oxygen that she needed. Ganon.
Yeah, I think her body gave in. She had a lot of complications. She had a lot of previous conditions.
Yeah. What were, only if you can share them with us, what were the previous conditions of Claire? Was she diabetic, hypertensive? Anong condition niya, Gigo?
And diabetic.
Diabetic siya.
I didn't even know. According to my titas, she developed asthma, which I never knew and I've never seen her, but apparently she did.
Oo. So kumbaga diabetic na siya, tapos nagka-asthma siya. And prior to being a COVID positive, no? Is it true that you got it from the help at home, that the help goes out? This is just helpful information for everyone watching.
Yeah, we can't say 100% sure.
Yes.
But on our end of investigation, because no one, the only people in the house, that were in and out of the house were the people who had to buy essentials for us.
Yes.
Because mom decided like 3 weeks ago that we weren't allowed to be in public anymore.
Yeah. You know, Gigo, wow, I can only imagine how you're coping at the moment. The fact that you can't even visit the hospital because you yourself are technically a carrier right now. What about your brother? Do you have a brother there?
Yeah, he's the one taking care of things right now. He's negative.
Okay. Oh, he is not positive. He's not COVID positive.
Yes, he's not COVID positive. Actually, I was talking to my mom before and asking her, Ma, can you ask the doc if I could just be admitted as well so you'd have someone with you there? I don't think I was allowed. So, yeah.
I guess... What are the plans in terms of, I mean, it's too soon to ask you clearly, but how will you, I mean, clearly times have changed. When someone dies and the person is COVID positive, even a loved one, did they tell you how our weeks will be conducted, how to move, to go about this?
Well, yes, they told me that I had two options. We had two options. It's either if we wanted her buried right away, we had to bury her within 12 hours. Or other than that, we had to cremate her.
And what was your family's choice?
Well, I've decided for my brother that we wanted to have her. Even in just, you know, in any way possible for one last time here at home. So I told him that we'll just have her cremated.
Yes.
And, bring her home.
Yes.
Even though we can't see her.
Yeah. Yeah.
At least just for a few days. I think she would, you know, there are a lot of people who want to say goodbye to her.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I'm hoping that my PCR test yesterday shows that I'm negative by now, so that I could go with my brother and witness her cremation.
Yeah. Will they allow you, Gigo? No, I'm just curious in terms of you tested positive on Friday, the 26th.
Yeah.
If it's negative today, will you be allowed out?
I was told that I would be allowed at least just to for that.
Okay.
As long as I maintain my social distancing and that the protocol is, other than that, I still need to do my quarantining here at home, yeah, like my brother.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, there are people who are helping us, her best friends, my titas, you know, they're making sure that we're taken care of for now.
Yeah. You know, your mother is a music icon, a singing icon. She's special to many sectors. She also fought for the plight of jeepney drivers, operators at one point. But more than that, you know, she's your mother. And during the Dasera situation, I remember just how she stood up for you. First, she was the first one to really speak and defend you and say that she accepted that it was impossible for you to have done it, because she had said, number one, she outed you, so to speak, no? She did, you and her together. And it just, can you describe the kind of relationship that you have, you know, that, that clearly will be missed?
Describing our relationship is complicated. We have our ups and downs, we have our issues. But the thing is, there was one particular issue back in the past that I think she's, ever since, she has been trying to make up for and told me that she really did love me. That's why she fought tooth and nail. So I would say that, you know, most recently, we have been closer. We have been it's hard to describe it because we never really got to close that door, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
But I always thought that, you know, parang our relationship, we felt like siblings. Siya yung makulit na younger sibling na kailangan alagaan because matigas ulo niya, she doesn't eat right, or she worries a lot, and I'm the one who tries to make sure that she calms herself down. This case honestly took a lot on from her. And I wish I could. That's my only regret, that she didn't get to see the finish line. Na parang, mawala ka na, kailangan alalahanin. Okay na, tapos na.
Yeah. There's so many, I'm sure, who've tried to reach out to you just to show you their love and mourn with you. Is there anything you want to say before we go?
To the people who have been messaging, calling, unfortunately right now I'm not capable of answering all of them, but I would like you to know that I'm very grateful. I'm sure my mom is, for the support and for looking out for me and my brother at this very difficult time. We are doing our best to get through this, and we know that we will. But thank you for everything.
Spiritually speaking, your mom passed away during Holy Week. We're moving into Holy Thursday, Good Friday, remembering the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Is there, does this resonate with you in some way?
I guess it does now that you mention it. First off, my mom was very religious. She's very close to God. She always spoke to Him every night and every morning. And in a way, I, you know, recently I realized somehow she was preparing for this moment. The past couple of months, there were signs already, just didn't really expect it to happen right now. But in a way, it's like I should have seen all the signs, maybe, that she was preparing me and she was preparing to leave, or at least God was helping her prepare to leave so that all her affairs would be in order, that we would have the support system that we needed. So I guess, you know, God was preparing everything for her. Yeah.
All right. Well, Gigo, please hang in there. You stay strong and you stay safe. And we are just sending you, from all of us here at ANC, our deepest, sincerest condolences on your mom's passing. And just hang in there, okay?
Thank you so much, Karen.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. And I apologize for waking you up, frankly, but thank you so much. This is deeply appreciated. All right. To everyone watching, Head Start, we'll be right back. Please stay with us.
About the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school, they look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students. Think about the millennials and the young physicians coming out of medical school. They look for work-life balance, they look for flexibility, they look for consistency, predictability in their lives. We'd like to continue to push with the schools, and we're working with quite a few of the big schools to promote primary care, especially to incoming and current medical students. Thank you.
Welcome back to Head Start. I'm Karen Davila, working from home this Holy Wednesday. And the COVID-19 pandemic continues to limit the public in holding long valued traditions. And among them is celebrating Holy Week really in church, one of the most important events for the Catholic faithful and the Christian faithful. Joining us now on Hot Copy as we reflect on Lent in the time of the pandemic, we have with us Father Luciano Felloni, parish priest of Kristong Hari Church. Father Luciano, good morning to you.
Good morning. Kumusta po?
All right. Now, well, first and foremost, masses are no longer allowed, this ECQ. So what do you have in store for the faithful? I mean, at least let's start with Kristong Hari Church. What are your plans?
Yes. Well, isa sa mga naging focus is let's focus kung ano ang pwede.
Uh-oh.
Kasi nakakalungkot yung hindi pwede. Maraming hindi pwede at we are familiar with procession, salubong, daang krus, siete palabras. But all of that ay hindi pwede physically. So first of all, we shift to virtual. So that's something that we can still do it. So we have our masses regularly. All the celebrations of Holy Week will be live on our Facebook page in the parish. We will have the virtual seven last words. We will have the virtual Daang Cruz. So we will have a lot of the ceremonies virtually. But on beside of that, we are telling the people, transform your house into a church.
Galing, paano? Sige nga. Okay. So sinasabi mo to. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. For example, last Sunday, we asked the parents have to be the spiritual leader ng family. So, last Sunday, we asked them, prepare your branches, kahit hindi yung palm, kahit anong sanga ng puno. Now, we will bless the water online, and then the father of the family will bless yung palaspas ng mga kasama niya sa bahay.
Uh-oh.
Pagdating sa bukas, ang gagawin ko, huhugasan ko yung paa ng kasama kong pare. Isa lang, yung kaming dalawa lang kasi sa studio. Now, we will ask the father of the family, ikaw ang maghugas ng paa ng mga miyembro ng pamilya.
Ay, ang ganda!
Pagdating so, ng Holy Friday, yes, may role.
May involvement. May participation.
Yes, yes. And it should be, actually, both it should be, na ang tahanan ay simbahan sa bahay. What we call domestic church. At pangalawa, na parents should be spiritual leaders. Hindi po pwedeng ipasa yung, you cannot outsource pagiging spiritual leader. Hindi mo pwedeng ipasa sa school, ipasa sa simbahan, the primary role of the parents. Kaya, in a positive sense, on this pandemic, let the parents be the spiritual leader doon sa tahanan nila.
Oo. Okay, so kumbaga, it's in your Facebook page. Lahat ng events, so to speak, our traditions, buhay pa rin, pero magiging virtual na ito. Okay. Father Luciano, with the death, you know, many, many Filipinos are dying and actually we're hearing more, you know, dying more now, I think because yes. of, you have the strain that's more transmissible.
Yes.
And the death of Claire de la Fuente actually sent shockwaves, no? Because considering, you know, people knew her, she was famous, she was 63, she was
yes.
just in the news recently because of her son in the De Sera case. And the story that came out was, even if you wanted to get the help that you need, is the hospitals are so full
yes.
that they may not be able to give it to you immediately, you know?
Yes.
So that's put in a different kind of fear.
Mm. Definitely, terrible. A lot of pressure sa lahat ng nakasakit at lahat ng maging contact sa mga nakasakit. And now I think we all have. We all have been in contact with people that have been sick. And yung torture na hindi mo alam kung anong mangyayari sa'yo, that mental torture is one of the most difficult things.
Yeah.
Doon, ang pananampalataya ay isa sa mga malalakas na nagbibigay sa atin ng lakas ng loob. Like yesterday night, I had a recollection about the Good Friday, the theology of the cross. And there were five people watching from the hospital. na hospital dahil sa na COVID with pneumonia with severe symptoms, and they said ito po yung nagbibigay sa amin ng lakas ng loob, yung kapit sa pananampalataya. And you know, Holy Week shows that all our pains are two things. One is temporary, lilipas din yan. At pangalawa is transitory, may patutunguhan. It's not, hindi por nada yun eh. So, yun ang lakas ng loob. Kasi pag nasa gitna ka ng pagsubok, feeling mo walang katapusan ito at feeling mo walang silbi, walang kwenta. And that's when our faith changes how we see the cross. We yeah. know that it's temporary, that hindi ito tatagal. The last word will always be victory, not suffering.
Yeah. You know, Filipinos and all over the world, frankly, when it's Easter weekend, Filipinos plan to go on vacation because you're yes. off work, you know. And I was one of those, really, because TV used to be under maintenance Thursday to also yes. was an yes. opportunity for to go, you know, and many yes. companies yes. were that. So Filipinos would plan to go yes. on vacation, but also have a prayer time there. And this whole global situation, yes. what is God trying to tell us? And how do you relate it now to celebrating Holy Week and Easter? Yes.
Well, I think this is the closest to the original Holy Week, to the first real Holy Week, because they were all with fear, they were all afraid, and they were all locked down. If you remember, all the accounts of the resurrection start by saying, nakatipon sila, nakasara ang pinto ng bahay.
The apostles were locked down.
They were all locked down in fear.
Yes.
And so we are very much close to the original Holy Week. There is so much fear, incertitude, sadness, and lockdown. And that can be an opportunity to bring us closer to Jesus, not only to be close in the days of fear, but also in the days of joy and resurrection, new hope, a panibagong pananaw. And I think that's the point. We have to, Pope Francis said it beautifully. This is a big crisis. You never come out of a crisis the same. You come out better or worse. So yeah. I think yun ang challenge sa atin. I think God is trying to tell us, come on guys, wake up. Your yeah. world wasn't normal.
Yeah.
Your priorities were not okay. What was important was not online. So this is an opportunity to come out better after this crisis.
Yeah. What a powerful message, Father Luciano. It's God telling us, hey, look, wake up. Your life wasn't normal. That wasn't yeah. okay.
Yes. Therefore, it's not going back to normal because that wasn't normal. Hindi naman normal yun eh. Our life was a disaster, ang gulo ng planeta, ang gulo ng ekonomiya, ang gulo ng politika. So if we are dreaming to go back to there, hello, that will be very stupid from us. Take the opportunity and come out better.
Come out better. What about Easter? I mean, before we go, how would you want people to see Easter this time so it has really, you know, a deeper, more impactful meaning for them? You know, we often take for granted the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We yes. say it so flippantly. Oh, what's Easter? He resurrected from the dead, right? Yes. And like Father, but we forget the power of yes. the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Yes. And I think what we need to do really is never to disconnect the cross from the resurrection. It's a whole mystery together. You enter in this door, you come out on this door. And you cannot have resurrection if you don't transform your suffering, giving meaning, make it your mission, being transformed. Lahat yun ay nangyari sa Panginoon. Between Friday and Sunday, there was a total transformation come around. The power of his life came again in the same place kung saan siya na ilibing. So the place ng kanyang libingan ay naging place ng kanyang muling pagkabuhay. And I think that's for us, the same. Where we fall down, when we are broken, that's the place where we need new life.
Wow, ang galing ah. I feel like all of us went to a retreat this morning listening to you.
the very same place. That's where we have new life. Yes, okay. Yes. Father, anything you'd like to add before we go? Would you like to share a message? Or may panawagan ka ba?
Yes.
Anything you'd like to say?
Yes, well, I would like to really to invite all of us, really all of us, to use these days to get closer to God and to each other, and to each other. There are a lot of people that need us these days. In many ways, they need us to extend some financial help. They need us to pray for them. They need us to make a phone call. Some people are very lonely in this lockdown. So don't get self-absorbed. Hindi lang yung sarili mong isipin mo. I think this Holy Week is an invitation to look around, reach out to people in different ways. Try to make it meaningful, not only for you and your family, but also for people that you can reach out. In this, we are together. We really need to help each other this time.
Beautifully said. Thank you so much, Father Luciano, for blessing us all this morning. Thank you so much. God bless you, and you take care of yourself, Father.
Thank you. You too. God bless, Bo.
All right. God bless you. All right. That's Head Start today. And I do hope that before we go, coming from our interview with Guigo de la Fuente and also Father Luciano, that you enter this Holy Week, for those watching, with a deeper sense of meaning and appreciation for what it really is. As Father Luciano said, come out transformed. Stay safe. Stay informed and keep it here on ANC.